Hello and welcome to another episode of the Agency Leadership Podcast. I'm Chip Griffin.
And I'm Jenny Dietrich.
And if you're listening to us, then the clickbait worked. So we'll talk more about the actual topic right after this. We are not above clickbait headlines, so that's what we went with.
Yeah.
We are going to be talking about the four-day work week, which I know all of you would love to have. It's like a popular topic of conversation. 4 days, 4 hours. Let's go all the way back to that that wonderful book, The 4-Hour Work Week, the biggest piece of trash I've ever read.
Tell us how you really feel about it.
I blogged about it at the time. In fact, I think that the way I let it off was that the book suggested that if you found something to be a waste of time, just stop it. And so I said, so I stopped reading at that point.
Yes.
Because it was a waste of my time. I mean, look, there were some good ideas in there, but you know, the whole 4-hour work week is a dumb idea. I mean, it's not realistic.
Just like clickbaity?
Yes. The book was actually advocating that you could do, you could work just four hours.
How?
Sure. I mean, well, you could if you could charge enough for those 4 hours that it covered whatever you wanted to earn. I mean, you can work just 4 hours a week. Absolutely. You just have to either be able to charge through the nose for those 4 hours, or you have to not want to make very much. So you certainly could do it if those are criteria you want to meet. But unfortunately, that book set an unrealistic expectation for people. So let's talk about something that is a little bit more realistic. It's in the realm of reality, the 4-day work week. And there has been a lot of conversation lately as people are thinking about, you know, what does the new work look like post-pandemic, assuming we ever come out of the pandemic, right? Or, you know, whatever.
It becomes
how do we structure work generally, and agencies are you know, trying to think creatively. And so I know a number of them are thinking about the idea of a 4-day work week. And is that something that could work to give the team some more flexibility, have a better opportunity to attract talent, all those different kinds of things. So the 4-day work week, what are your thoughts?
You know, I am a fan. I have tried for many, many years to figure out how to make that work. We do summer hours on Fridays during the summer. And what we started with was half a day, like we would close the office at one every Friday. And that worked pretty well. And so we were like, okay, well, let's, like, you know, clients are gone Friday afternoons too during the summer. So it wasn't that big of a deal. So then we said, okay, well, let's just be closed all of Friday. And that did not work at all. Like, right. Because clients, there's still work to be done, and clients still have expectations, and there's, you know. So what we ended up doing is doing half and half. So we would do every other week. So if you had this Friday off, I would have next Friday off, and we would rotate, mm-hmm. right? So, and that worked pretty well because then things were covered. But we only do it for the summer. We started after Memorial Day and ended at Labor Day. I think that the bigger challenge is that because we're in client service and because clients aren't working 5 days a week, they're not super keen to hear, oh, well, we're closed on Friday. They don't care. They want the work done, right?
Right.
And you still have all the work to do. So then what I found is people were working on Sundays, and then they were all stressed out because they weren't getting their work done. And so we have not figured out the right formula for that. I would still love to be able to, but we just have not figured it out in the business that we're in.
I think you've touched on the important aspect of this, is that it's not really just our decision, right? When you're in business, you have to think about your clients, your customers, whatever. And so, you know, a restaurant could certainly be open 4 days a week. The question is, can they generate enough revenue in those four days? Will their, you know, customers still stick with them? You know, if I've got a grocery store, if I only open 4 days a week, that's going to be a real challenging business to run.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And so in the agency world, we serve clients. And so as long as our clients by and large are on 5-day work weeks, it's difficult for us to go to at least a pure 4-day. And so I think what you've described, where it's sort of, you know, a hybrid 4-day, if you will, where you get 4 days every other week and someone else is covering for you, or, you know, you know, shifted schedules so that there's always coverage during that Monday through Friday traditional work week. And we can certainly have a debate at some point over whether 5-day work weeks make sense generally. And
they've been around for a long time.
Yeah. We're not going to change them on our own. So until it changes around us,
right?
You know, it's hard to be a trailblazer when you're an agency because you are serving the clients. And particularly the more that you're in things like public relations, you're already 5 days is even tough anyway, right? Because if your client has a media relations issue on a weekend, you kind of got to cover it. You can't say, I'm sorry.
Oh, sorry.
Monday through Saturday. Friday only. You know, no crises on the weekend. Sorry. Can't do it.
Or events. So, like events the same.
Or events,
yeah. Yeah, I agree with you. I think it's pretty challenging. And the other challenge that we have is we work with an international clients. So, you know, in many cases, they're 7 or 9 hours ahead of us. And so they don't care because not only is it an inconvenience for them because they have to wait for us to wake up by the time they're leaving work, but then to hear us say, oh, well, we're not open on Fridays. No, that does not.
Mm-mm. Right. Well, and the challenge with international too is there are parts of the world that are not Monday through Friday for their work week.
That's true.
And so when I was doing a lot of international business, there was a window of time on Saturday when everybody was closed. It was a very short window on Saturday, and that was it, because there are parts of the world that are, you know, Sunday through Thursday for the work week. And so if you're doing a lot of international business with those countries, enjoy your Saturday.
Right.
As much of it as you can
that's
get.
That's it. Yeah. It's true.
Because by 10 o'clock at night, your clients are probably coming online, you know, for the start of their work week on their Sunday morning.
Yep. Yeah.
So it is so dependent upon who you're serving. And I think that's going to drive how much flexibility agencies have into the future.
Yeah. And I will also say that, you know, I think many of us, myself included, are looking at, you know, hybrid work hours as well to accommodate. Like I always joke that school is not made for working parents because they start at 8:30 and they're out by 2:45. And you're like, I can't, this is not how the workday flows. You can't like, so, you know, we try to accommodate, you know, what I would call non-traditional hours or flex hours so that you can handle those kinds of things during the day. But I've also found that some people, not everybody, take advantage of that where they're like, oh, I can work non-traditional hours. So I'll just work all night and then do my stuff during the day with my family and not pay attention to you during the day. And that doesn't work either. Like you still have to be available during working hours and not, you know, doing your work during the nighttime so that, like, that just doesn't work. It doesn't work because you have stuff coming up. You have meetings that need to be scheduled. You have, you know, emails that need to go out. You have work that needs to get done. And it can't wait till 2 o'clock in the morning in most cases.
Right. And I think that that's one of the fundamental challenges that agencies have, because I think by and large, agency owners, agency employees would love to have more flexibility in how, when, where work is done.
Yeah.
But how do you do that in such a way that you're giving the, you know, an amount of freedom that makes sense, but doesn't hold up the rest of the team, right? Because in your particular example, let's say that you don't even have necessarily meetings that you have to go to, and, you know, maybe you're doing writing. And so if you do it at 2 o'clock in the morning, it's okay. It's still potentially holding up something else in the process, because if the rest of the team is looking for that information and they don't get it till 2 o'clock in the morning, now they're into the next business day before they can work with it if they're working more traditional hours. And so trying to figure out how all these different puzzle pieces fit together, you know, becomes the real challenge. And I think that agency leaders are really going to struggle with this in the months and years to come, trying to figure out how can I give you the freedom that you're looking for, and that by and large makes sense, but still make sure that it fits into the overall picture of what we're doing as a business.
Yeah. I mean, you still have to run your business. You still have to do the work. You still have to keep clients happy. You still have to be available. And so if you can figure out a 4-day work week, and maybe it is some sort of hybrid where it's not every week, like we do during the summer, maybe it's something like that, but to be able to say we are only open Monday through Thursday or Tuesday through Friday or whatever happens to be, I think for the work that we do is extraordinarily challenging.
Absolutely. I think there are ways that you can begin to test it, though, right, without fully going to it. So, for example, you could declare that Fridays are a no meeting day.
Yeah.
And so you don't schedule them with your own team, and you do everything you can to avoid scheduling client meetings on Friday or Monday or whatever day of the week that you decide is going to be the day. And so at some point, if you look at everyone's calendars and they're pretty light, you know, maybe now you can just go to an on-call system, you know, for that day that you've carved out. So there are many steps that you can use to test it out and set yourself up for it if it's something that you're thinking. And certainly I would encourage doing things like that as opposed to just saying, you know, starting January 1, we're Monday through Thursday, good
right.
to everybody.
Right.
I think you can try some of those things to see how practical it is for you and your clients, because it really is a case-by-case situation depending on the kinds of clients you have and, you know, the kind of work that you do. I mean, how much interaction do you need to have with clients on a day-to-day basis? How responsive to real-time events are you? I mean, if you're building large websites and it's, you know, it's not a real-time interaction, you might be okay.
Yeah.
If you're doing crisis PR,
not,
4, 5, 6, no. you're 720, you're 24/7, right. regardless of what right. you want.
Sometimes right? holidays I mean, that's just, too, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's just, yeah. that is the reality of that kind of agency. So a lot of it is going to depend and, you know, we always like to end the show with it depends. But I think you can take some of those steps to try out the theory and see how much flexibility you actually have to re-engineer things for your agency business.
Yeah, and I will tell you, there are some things you can do from a client perspective too, because I have a client who loves their 5 o'clock Friday afternoon meetings. Why anybody wants to have a meeting at 5 o'clock on Friday? It's still beyond me. So when we started working with them, I said to them, we do not do meetings past noon on Friday. So if you want us in that meeting, you're going to have to change it. And all of a sudden they all went, oh, this is much better. Why were we doing meetings at 5 o'clock on Fridays? Because right. you're stupid. That's why you're stupid.
Right. Well, but that goes to the challenge that a lot of agencies have, that they just, you know, they salute every request that a client gives them. They don't push back. They don't say, hey, how about this or that? Or and I think that clients are much more willing to be accommodating for the most part.
Right.
Not all of them, not yes. all of the time.
Yes.
But they are far more understanding than we give them credit for. And before we simply say yes to a request that we know is going to make us unhappy, our team unhappy, it's going to make our lives difficult, why not at least try?
Yeah.
To set yourself up for success.
Absolutely. You know, and what we found in that particular instance is that the leadership team who had required the meeting, everybody else below them was like, thank you. Because nobody had ever said, why are we doing this? And it was just convenient to the execs. It wasn't convenient right. for anybody else. And so everybody was very grateful from that perspective. But listen, if you want me and my brain to be thinking really strategically, 5 o'clock on Friday is not the right time. It's just not, because I'm dead by then. So,
well, but that's a great point that you've made there too, because so often as the outside advisor, we have more leverage to correct some of the sure. decisions that senior management makes, because while we are beholden to them for our contracts, they don't sign our paycheck every week.
Right.
And that does change the dynamic. And it so does. A lot of times I've found, particularly when I'm coming into a new relationship with an agency, if I can figure out from the team things that they've wanted to do or wanted to change, that I can simply say, yeah, we should change that. It can help get things across the goal line that maybe they've wanted to do all along, but didn't have either the leverage, the courage, or whatever to do. And so you can then build some real allies within your client's business by doing those things. So, you know, whether that's meeting times or something else, discover those, help them out, and it helps you out.
Yeah. And I to that point, I always say, you know, usually to the mid-level employees for our clients, I will say, listen, this isn't fair. It's not right, but it's human nature. If there are things that you want done or things that you need accomplished or decisions you need made, let me or my team handle it for you, because as the quote unquote consultant, we are seen at a different level, and it's not right and it's not fair,
no.
but that's just how it works. So
yep.
I have that conversation all the time. Like, if you don't want to have 5 o'clock on Friday meetings, let's get that changed because I'm not doing it.
I remembered in one of my very early jobs, they had a management consultant come in to try to figure out how operations could improve. And I remember hating it at the time. Like, oh, God, this is so painful that I got to have these meetings with this person. And then I quickly realized just that they were perceived differently. And so every other time I encountered that over the course of my career, I just used it to my advantage because I said, you know what? I can just tell them what it is that I need done. And more often than not, they're going to take it and run with it.
Yep.
You know, and you got to figure out each individual consultant because some are as open as you and I are, where it's just like, just, you know, tell me what I need to be bad cop on. I'm happy to do it.
Yep.
So, sometimes you have to help them think it's their own idea, and that's fine too. I mean, you know, I play internal politics if I have to, sure. but, you know, use those to your advantage as an agency because it gives you more power to be successful, but it also strengthens the relationship with the people that you're going to be working with every day. And oftentimes we think so much as an agency about pleasing the decision maker that we forget that the real people that we need to keep happy are the folks we're working with every day.
Yep.
Because if they become squeaky wheels and keep complaining about us, that's going to end the relationship faster than everything else because they're much more willing to fire an agency than an internal employee. It's a whole lot less painful for them, times out of 10. And most businesses will allow all sorts of problem employees to stick around, and the agency is the one that loses out. So don't let yourself be in that circumstance.
Yeah. And I will say, I mean, I think it certainly takes a level of confidence, but I think you're right. I think that as agency leaders, we're in a position to be able to do those kinds of things and make those kinds of changes. Can we go in and say, all right, you guys, we want to be close. We want to do a 4-day work week. So you should do a 4-day work week too. Like, that's probably not going to happen.
No.
But, you know, there are changes you can make, I think.
Yeah. And it's important to lay the groundwork early in a relationship if you can. Right. So if when you start working with a client, you say, you know, we don't do meetings on Fridays, that's our day to do internal work, or Mondays, or, you know, whatever it is. Or, you know, maybe it's in my case, I try to avoid meetings on Monday morning and Friday afternoon because I like to have the beginning and end of the week to either kick it off, you know, the way I want to, or wrap it up so I don't feel like things are overhanging me on the weekend. But whatever works for you and your team, just lay those ground rules out and do whatever you can to protect those, you know, whether it's meeting times, I don't do 7 a.m. meetings or, you know, whatever. Lay those out from the beginning and you'll be in much better shape. If you say, oh, well, you know, it's just, I'm going to make an exception. I'll do a 7 a.m. meeting, you know, because we're just getting started and everybody's enthusiastic and I don't want to hold things up. Guess what? You're going to be doing 7 a.m. meetings for a long time.
Right.
You've created the expectation. You do 7 a.m. meetings. And so next time when they ask for it, what do you say? You certainly can push back. It's a lot more difficult once you've said yes once.
It's a lot more difficult, yeah. We had a client like that where I allowed myself to get suckered in. And she would schedule 2.5-hour meetings. And in the beginning, I was like, okay, like I can do 2.5-hour meetings because – we need to get through and we have lots of decisions to make and stuff like that. But, you know, 3 months into the relationship, 2.5-hour meetings, first of all, nobody has time for that. And secondly, there was no need for them. So I started to push back and say, like, we just need a half an hour here and a half an hour there to get. And she did not like that because she didn't get her 2.5-hour therapy session every week. And I was like, I can't continue to do this, but it was extraordinarily hard for me to change that after the fact than if I had just said at the beginning, we can do a half an hour on Tuesday and a half an hour on Thursday, and that's just it.
Right. And it really is tough because people don't even think about it after a while, right? So there was, when I was doing a lot of the international work, or, you know, halfway around the world, I was doing occasional 4 a.m. conference calls.
Yep.
That's a miserable thing to do, even though I'm generally up pretty early anyway.
Miserable. You still don't want to be talking to people at that time.
No, and it was one of those things where, you know, it was one of those, I got an email one day and said, oh, we can just hop on the phone now because it was a good, convenient time for me. I knew I had a busy day ahead. Let's just do it. But then in their mind, oh, well, you're available. And so now mm-hmm. we'll just schedule them for 4 a.m., mm-hmm. 5 a.m., mm-hmm. those kinds of things. And so then you have to unlearn that behavior for
right.
them
right.
And train them in a different way. And that is far more difficult. So you're far better off if you set those expectations early, particularly if you're thinking about doing something, you know, more creative with how you're managing your team, like a 4-day work week, like flexible hours, all those kinds of things. The more rules, process, whatever that you can put around it so that your whole team is, you know, rowing in the same direction, the more likely you are to be successful.
Yeah, I think boundaries are good. Setting expectations up front are good. And like you said, clients tend to be pretty open to that stuff at the beginning of the relationship. So set the boundaries, set expectations. Like I say to my team all the time, if you want to answer emails after dinner time or while you're watching TV at night, whatever it happens to be, that's fine, but schedule them, because if you don't schedule them and you send them at 9 o'clock at night, the client's going to expect that you're going to be working at 9 o'clock every night. So that we have those conversations all the time, because I have team members who are night owls and like to do that. And I always say, that's fine. You can do that.
But right. And that was a lesson I learned many years ago, because I often responded whenever I would get something, because it was easier for me just to respond and get it off my plate. And
course.
Years ago, it was a lot harder to schedule responses.
Yeah.
Right? But unfortunately, I ended up conditioning clients, coworkers, other people to believe that I was essentially always available.
Right.
And while I don't mind that, because I am, you know, a workaholic and I don't care and all that kind of stuff, it just made it difficult, because if I got tied up on something and wasn't able to respond, not because I was choosing not to work, but because I was working on something else, they then said, well, we were so surprised we didn't hear from you. And so then you get the follow-up emails. You know what? Why didn't you respond to this? Well, because I was actually doing something else.
And it's 10 o'clock at night. Like, I've conditioned you to be worried when I don't respond at 10 o'clock at night, which is ridiculous.
Right, exactly. So, you know, you have to think about those things. And the more that you set those up, the more ability that you have to be creative in doing the things that you need to do in order to structure your team and their work hours and all of that in a way that is conducive to both producing great results for your clients as well as helping you with recruitment and retention of the talent, because that's so difficult right now. You have to be thinking creatively. It just requires a lot of moving pieces to come together in the right way.
Yep. Yep. So set expectations, set your boundaries, help clients understand why you're doing something. And I'm sure in most cases, not all, most cases, they'll be happy to accommodate.
And hopefully people will be happy that they clicked on this clickbaity headline to come and listen to this episode of the Agency Leadership Podcast. But that will draw this episode to a close because, well, I mean, I only plan to work 4 days this week. So
I'm only working 4 hours, so I'm done. This is my fourth hour.
That's more than you usually work. So
it is.
On that note, I'm Chip Griffin.
And I'm Jenny Dietrich.
And it depends. Thank you for listening to the Agency Leadership Podcast. You can watch or listen to every episode by visiting agencyleadershippodcast.com. The Agency Leadership Podcast is distributed on the FIR Podcast Network. Just visit www.firpodcastnetwork.com. We welcome your feedback and suggestions and look forward to being back with you again next week.